Leaving this morning for the 10th Stampede, my second attempt at it. I'll go over the stuff I did to the bike to modify it to make it more Stampede worthy here. So, as you can see, the right hand side looks just like it has after I've modified it with the new Super Glide 2-in-1, but you can see the seat's a little bit taller. I got the 4-inch springs in there, as well as I put a gel. I opened up the seat, took off a layer of foam, put in gel, so hopefully that'll be a little bit more comfortable. I've actually got my rear end all set up now with some quality spacers that cinch up the gap in the axle plate and everything. So that's going to be a lot better, hopefully. This side is completely open now, so I don't have that rub that I had before. I made this bracket here with it's got a hidden spring behind it to keep the weight off of the throwout bearing, and then some old Harley parts for this piece, and the shifting linkage just runs through that piece of, it's just plumbing pipe welded in there. So that's basically the big picture since the last video I did. No other changes. So I'm excited to get started, and hopefully this year will go as well. Hopefully the end results of this year will be the same as last year, and hopefully this year will go a lot smoother.
Yep, that's after about 500 kicks. Didn't show you the rest of them. Riding here in the eastern North Carolina tunnel of trees. I thought it would be cool to record these with these rocks going by on the left-hand side, but it's not that interesting riding in the East Coast. It's just pretty much a tunnel of trees. Once you get into western North Carolina and Tennessee, it starts to get a little bit more mountainous and beautiful. Unfortunately, the fisheye kind of flattens out all the terrain, but it's really quite cool. And then I camp down for the night in a rest area, so get ready for my, after 2 hours of sleep, morning recording where I sound like a moron.
This morning of day two. This is where I bedded down for the night. I am about 100 miles to the west of Memphis. Covered about 950 miles yesterday, Goldsboro to Memphis. Everything went really smooth except for the bolt on the rear mount of my fuel tank. Kept walking out, so I had to stop at all those, get another rubber washer and put that back in with some Loctite and stuff. I don't know why I didn't do that before I left. I knew it was bad. My backpack went flying off the back of the bike at 70 miles an hour last night, so I'm glad the camera still works. Other than that, everything's good. You can see the bike over there, way over there.
That was actually probably the scariest part of the whole trip. I'm riding and I feel something slap against my back, and it turns out that it was the bungee cord coming undone. And then as I reached back to see what was going on, I felt my bag just move off to my left. So at that point, I'm worried that my rear wheel spokes are going to get tangled up in the bag and all that stuff. I'm going 70 miles an hour. It's 2 in the morning. I've got a big rig behind me. So I just pull over as quick as I can, pull my flashlight out, run back with my, I leave my lights on the bike so nobody plows into me. I run back and my bag is right out in the middle of the highway. So I run out and grab it. Big rigs are flying by all over the place. The bag had split open and shit all my tools all over everywhere. So I'm running around trying to find sockets and wrenches and stuff like that. I finally get everything all bagged up and get back on the bike and hit the road. And luckily I didn't have an inventory before I left, but I think all my tools were intact.
Matt Leary's Custom Cycle in New Mexico. Stopped in to take care of some stuff on the bike. Fixed my throttle. So the spring is good. Put a new throttle on there with a new grip because the other one was coming apart. And then fixed up, shored up some screws that were coming out of my foot peg bracket, as well as changing the oil for 60 weight so I could get through the Mojave tomorrow. So as you can see, they've got a pretty good shop, good dudes, in Alamogordo and stop by and give them some business if you get a chance.
For the record, Larry's Custom Cycle is actually in Albuquerque. I was a little bit confused at that time. Doesn't really get fun until you start getting strung out, so that's what I was doing to myself on purpose. In this video, you can see I'm starting to get out into the west. My handlebar mount broke, so I'm just holding the GoPro, which I think actually puts out some better footage. The bluffs out to my right are actually like 500-foot bluffs creeping out of the mist. It was really beautiful. And you can see how the terrain has changed from the east coast where you're just going through that tunnel of trees. Now it's wide open. There's huge mountains, and it's totally awesome. The riding out west could not be more fun to do. Sorry about the duck lips. I think I'm kind of self-conscious while I'm filming myself here.
So I hiked about 7 miles to go up and see the Grand Canyon, all to save $30 for not having to bring the vehicle on the park. When I get there, all I see is this. But I hung out for a little while, and eventually the fog blew off. Which was cool. Because I love standing on the edge of huge drops, just feeling them suck you in. It's one of the few things that actually make me physically afraid. It's pretty fun. It's a long walk though. It's like 7 miles. It sucks.
Unfortunately, the video didn't really come out. You can barely see them, but right over there on the outside of the path, there is a huge male elk and a bunch of female elks, like 15 female elks. So I'm sitting here trying to get some footage of them when the male elk stops eating, stands up, puffs out its chest, and starts looking at me. So now I'm standing up and getting away, and you're about to see some real terror there. That's what I look like when I'm peeing myself. And the rest of the time, I'm just, this is just admiring the natural beauty here at the Grand Canyon National Park.
Now for 300 miles to Barstow. Now only 300 miles to Barstow.
On this final section of the ride out, my rear mount on my gas tank is just coming unhinged. It just is totally, the threads that are in the frame are just totally spent and the thing is hammering itself out. I'm basically taking turns holding the tank down with my hand or locking out my throttle and doing it with my throttle hand. And I'm basically deciding here that I need to do something once I get to California about it before I point east again. As you can see, it's pretty barren terrain here, so I'm pretty much on edge because of my experience last year when my gas tank cracked open like a Easter egg and just poured gasoline all over myself. If that happened to me at this point, which is a very real possibility, I would be stranded at best, potentially lit on fire, but pretty nervous right here. It was a thrilling ride, to say the least. This is the California Inn where we stayed. We spent a lot of time back here in this pool hanging out. Guys were drinking, partying. This is all the bikes that showed up. It was over 50 people, somewhere between 50 and 60. While I was in California, I brought my bike down to Orange, went to the Tiger Shack where Ryan, the dude that owns the Tiger Shack, fixed me up. He's one of the guy born free builders. He built that Orange Triumph tricycle. He welded in a bung, threaded bung into my backbone so that wouldn't start winding out anymore. And then he cleaned up some of the welds, filled in some of the leaks, and put gussets on the back of my tank, so it was pretty much indestructible. Additionally, he added a rubber gusset or mount bushing off of a Triumph there, so the tank is now rubber mounted on all three points. This is the first two-stroke ever to be entered into the Stampede. It's got entered and also finished, so it's got a place in the history books. Everybody was real happy to see it finish because it's an awesome bike. It was not without a couple of adventures though. This guy broke his handlebar in half while he was at a toll station. Luckily, it didn't happen when he was going 70 miles an hour. These two guys are both named Tom, Tom Sr., Tom Jr. Tom Sr. ran the Stampede with a broken foot. These two choppers are pretty awesome too, two little sportster choppers that they made. This is Rich Evo Chopper, Rich's Evo Chopper. It's right along my lines in terms of style, so I was happy to see him finish as well. And then Juan here is a professional tattoo artist, and I always get a kick out of how precisely and carefully he writes everybody's numbers on, because that shit's important. You gotta look good, and if you're gonna have something written on your headlight, it's gotta look good, and Juan does a good job. The day before the race, all the bikes getting lined up. You can see a lot of interesting choppers. There's Eric Bernes, Sportster, big fan of that bike, and then a lot of what I would describe as Stampede bikes, which are bikes that meet the four rules, but are made to basically go fast and be comfortable. Some of them are a little bit bagger looking, in my opinion, but there are a bunch of solid choppers. There's Juan's bike, Medusa, the Evo chopper with the blue tank there. And then this is a perfect example of a Stampede bike. That's the Victor for the last 2 years in a row, Chris's bike. Thing moves cross country pretty quick. I probably wouldn't ride it around, but different strokes for different folks. There was four shovelheads that showed up with all of them had six speeds except for mine. So I was at a disadvantage, but I still came out on top. And then you can see there's Charlie's Midnight Rider and another shovelhead. There's Princess Penny from my buddy Fletch from knew him from last year. He completed last year. There's the Tom's Sportster's Rich's Evo, which you can get a good look at it here. It's pretty badass. And then over here you've got Grandpa's chopper, amazing slab side shovel with a Baker six speed. Grandpa's a real deal. And then over here you've got a that blue bike's completed a lot of stampedes. It's a pretty awesome little chopper. And then some that single banger, that kid put a brand new engine in his bike about the day before because it broke down on the way out. And then Speedo's YZF1 chopper, which had a little bit of petcock feed problems to the carburetor.
Here I am at the beginning of the race. It's Sunday morning at about 5:30. Everybody's getting ready and the bike's all prepped. We're going up 50 north to 70 east. To then 64 east, and then hitting Richmond and going 95 south, and then 64 west to US 1 that into Rockingham. So it's pretty exciting. There she is, number 33, all ready for the race. pretty much a lock for the win. Probably the fastest shovelhead that's ever lived.
6 o'clock sharp, we start out, so I'm here in the lineup waiting at the back of the pack because I know that I'm going to be going slower than almost everybody else with the four speed. As everybody starts launching off, it's quite a feeling of butterflies or nervousness in your stomach as you're about to point a custom hand-built bike across a 3,000 mile race where you can't really stop for very long, so it's a big stressful going through the desert on an old bike like that, on a 40-year-old motorcycle, because it can become kind of a life or death situation pretty quick. And there's a lot of just crazy stuff that you know is gonna happen, you know it's gonna be hard, but there's nothing you can do but just do it and force your way through to the finish line, which is a pretty satisfying experience. But at this point, you don't know what's gonna happen, and you're just pulling on throttle and heading out, and it's awesome. It's an awesome experience. Section I purposely edited out all of the video of people passing me and only put in video of me passing other people, so it makes me look like a superstar. You can see a lot of folks start going off to the side of the road early on where they start finding problems with their bikes, and you'll see through the rest of the footage every once in a while I'll pass somebody who broke down on the side of the road. But it is a race, so you can't stop for anybody else to make a change. Out here in the desert just south of Las Vegas, you got the Mojave Solar Project. You can see that off in the distance there. It's an awesome array of mirrors that go up to this one concentrator, and it's supposed to generate solar power. I guess it's not currently operational, but it's pretty impressive to look at. And then going through after Vegas, getting into the Rockies, there's some awesome canyons to carve through. It's like awesome Star Wars, you know, Death Star type experience. It's really fun. And then coming up here, you're gonna see Fuzzy on his Sportster broke down at the side of the road. It turns out he was just out of fuel, so he's sitting there hand pumping it in. It's pretty cool. But this was one of my favorite parts of the whole race here. There's Fuzzy. Hey, Fuzzy. Real fun riding through this area. This is just entering Utah, and there's finally some green brush and stuff. It's pretty significant when you get into this section of the Stampede because you've made it through the desert and you are pretty much sure that you're not going to die from exposure if you do break down. So as soon as you get through the desert, it's a big relief, and gas stations start getting a little bit more plentiful and towns and stuff like that. So now I'm breathing easy at this point.
First night of the race, we're about 200 miles to the east of Denver, maybe give or take. And so we covered about 1,000 miles first day, and now heading through, probably goal for today is Richmond. This is our camping area. Ran into Mike on the way. He's got a Sportster.
The second day of this stampede was my low point. Not only am I in Kansas, the center of the country, where it's not that interesting to ride through, but outside of Columbia, Missouri, I end up breaking down as I'm entering a wall of rain. You can see in this next scene, it's just like the lowest point of my life on the side of the road. Just engine's not working. It's pouring rain on me. I end up waiting on the side of the road and then getting hooked up using the S&S dealer locator with a really great guy. Picks me up and brings me into his shop. That's going to be the next scene here.
So right after filling up here in Columbia, Missouri, I had a problem where my ignition stopped and I couldn't start it. So it turned out that just like Charlie predicted, my Donna S had exploded. And luckily, Dave here from Dave's Racing,
Racing Dave's.
Racing Dave's,
Yes, sir.
helped me out. So look him up. He's on the S&S dealer locator, and he's got a full-up shop. And he's a really super knowledgeable guy. And he's got fair prices. And he's a good dude. He's got a pretty awesome shop as well.
Oh, gotta get the motorcycle in. All right,
And he's got an awesome Shovelhead here with a souped-up 74-inch.
The pain just kept on rolling. End up running out of gas and then pulling into this gas stop right here, and the pumps are shut off. So I sleep between the bike and the pump, and it just rains and thunderstorms all night, and the rain just washes in. Luckily, I've got my trusty wool blanket, and wool is one of those materials that helps you keep your warmth even when it's wet. So actually, it wasn't that bad of a night's sleep. I was there for like 6 hours before the pumps got turned back on, but it's just one of those things that you run into on the Stampede. This riding footage is going through Virginia, so it's real beautiful and mountainous there. However, it was like going in and out of rainstorms, so I was going from getting totally soaking wet to totally dry to soaking wet to totally dry. A little bit psychologically difficult, especially at the third day of the Stampede when I'm a little bit strung out already. But like I said, it's real beautiful riding there.
I'm here at the finishing line. I finished last night at about 10:30 at night. My total time was 61 hours and 20 minutes. As you can see, the bike is a little bit worse for wear. The only major issue I had on the road was when that charging system broke down. But in the course of the 2,800 miles in 3 days, I developed a couple new leaks. It was pretty tight before when I left. And now, as you can see, it takes about 10 minutes after stopping anywhere for it to make a little puddle there. But overall, bike went real good this year. I'm really happy with how it performed.
Was out in front of the Best Western where we finished the Stampede this year. The sign-up sheet was at the front desk, so you pull up here, run in, sign up at the front desk, and have the concierge witness it and sign her name next to it. There's a couple other bikes here showing up that are just here for the smokeout, not necessarily Stampede bikes, but the majority of what you see in this video are all competitors showing up at the finish line. This is some footage of the smokeout. So there's Tom and a couple of the bikes that we pulled out front. There's Grandpa's cool slab side 66. That's Eric Barnett's Sportster. Again, I'm a huge fan of that bike. It's awesome. This is where the back where all the Stampede bikes are collected. when Beardo pulled in. He tipped over on his bike and must have leaked some carb out of the carburetor, but the whole thing caught on fire, caught him on fire, and dudes started coming up and throwing sand on the bike, and unfortunately they were also throwing pine needles on it. Kind of made the fire bigger before it got smaller. It was kind of a exciting way to show up. Again, there's Grandpa's 66 slab side. I just can't get enough of that bike. He elongated the forks himself about 6 inches. He doesn't know how much longer. He just did it to look. He like set the bike up and just elongated it until it looked right. Flawless job. It looks like it came from the factory that way. There's 33, fastest shovel head. This is just a bike that I like, this pan head. I like that girder front end. A couple other bikes I just really like from the Smokeout. I always dig these LaPera seats like that. And this one's pretty cool, this pan head. I like that King Queen seat without the backrest. There's Tom Sr. Sportster. He had to get some work done. This is another one of the Stampede Shovelheads. Just a cool looking bike overall. I like choppers with stock fork geometry. Cool XS650. These bikes here have diesel engines. This is the hardtail one, my preferred of the two. Pretty crazy engineering to shoehorn a diesel engine into a hardtail frame like that, motorcycle frame. This one has a soft tail frame. It's still pretty cool engineering wise to get that motor in there. This is just a beautiful classic looking shovel head swing arm. There's a cool pan head. I like narrow bikes, so this one's nice looking. This is one of my favorite bikes at the Smokeout. It's a real stock geometry chopper. I like that short fishtail pipe, similar to mine. I like the stock style Springer front ends. I probably put a normal seat on there, but different strokes. I really like this little shovel head too. I like the mid controls going through the open belt. That's something that I also do. It's a real nice bike. I like the 2-in-1 high above the transmission. I've been on a FXR kick. I'm going to be getting myself an FXR here shortly. I just got to sell one of my bikes before I do it. But I really like this FXR. The FXR is the ugly duckling, but something about it, when you see it in person, it just looks kind of compact and good. I don't know how to describe it, really. Just an assortment of choppers here that I liked. Nice pan head with a 2-in-1. Another nice looking chopper. Evo choppers are something I'm a big fan of because I like anything that you can buy cheap and just run ragged. The Evo is all of that. Nice stock pan head. Another FXR. I just really recently can't get enough of these bikes. This bike is crazy. This bike is, first of all, it's got a solid mounted axle, so you can't adjust the axle. And then it's an iron head that's transmission's been cut away and it's been mounted to a 4-speed. So that's an intense amount of engineering on this bike, and it's probably one of the fanciest home-built bikes I've ever seen, or custom-built. There's a knucklehead, can't get enough of those. It's got a crazy dual carb setup, it's pretty wild. I don't know how you would ride that, where your leg would go, but it's probably pretty cool, it's pretty unique. I like that Shovelhead, just nice classic wide glide front end chopper. And this Shovelhead shows up a couple times in this video, I think. I like those Wassel style tanks. I wouldn't run one because it's just not enough fuel for me, but I really like how they look. Kind of just a cool pan head. I like that Springer front end. I usually don't like aftermarket Springers, but that one's kind of cool with the narrow front fork. Another just a good looking bike. Classic pan head chopper. A little bit more rake, upswept pipes. It's a real classic look on that one. There's Richie Pan's panhead. Unfortunately, I guess he got in an accident and, you know, lost his life right after this party, so that's tragic, but I hear he's a good dude. I like this seat on this bike. It's got like a king queen seat, but it's still got a low profile. This is real solid looking Shovelhead. I love that 2-in-1 with the martini shaker. I'm all about that exhaust. If I ever get a Baker 6-speed, I'm gonna do an exhaust just like that to run over the top of it. Cool iron head, nice stock low rider. Just a good looking machine, well taken care of or restored. And next to it, a nice skinny shovel head. Stockish looking pan head. I'd do something different with the air cleaner there. It's just it seems like the rest of the bike is real classic looking, and that air cleaner is a little bit more edgier. I don't hate those types of air cleaners, I just think it looks out of place on that bike a little bit, but I like the bike overall. Digger. That bike's pretty cool. There's a little sporty pan head. Nice chopper. There's that bike again. I just like that Wassel tank. And the 2-in-1 with a fishtail. I'm obviously a fan since I have that on my bike. There's a cool pan head. There's another.
Three times, and this is so he is getting his Stampede patch today. Congratulations, my man. Glad to meet
you. Go Lakes!
Oh, representing Ohio, I forgot about that. We got another Ohio guy over here. Okay, number 11. We have Andy Stevens, number 33, who's coincidentally also the fastest shovelhead, but with a time of 61 hours and 25 minutes. Way to go, Andy. It's his second year, so he gets an X. And, I'll get you back. He's up here. We got one. We've got a special award that was built by none other than this man. So let me hand it to him for a minute.
Shovel!
In my mind, every Stampede has two competitions. The person who finishes first, the person who finishes on the badass bike. So up until this point, no award has been presented to the badass bike. So I made this, which is handmade by me out of 1085 high carbon steel. And I made the case as well out of all raw materials. And what we did was all the finishers voted on the bike that they would take home and ride the rest of their life. So Grandpa, if you can come up.
Close in. Who's got a big camera out there to take a big picture for us?
So that's the end of the Stampede. It's kind of a weird thing to do on a vacation. Weird and expensive and destructive, but sort of like climbing a mountain, I guess. The only difference is that Stampede is an invisible mountain, but the only way you can really be sure that it even exists is that there's about 150 other dudes out there who've climbed it too. But it's good to be back. Well, the comforts of home. Look at my Rottweiler, who's eating some bird poop right now. And grass. Anyways, thanks for watching.